Hi, hello, welcome to Argumenter, the podcast stage to discuss, deliberate and debate on various contemporary social, legal and political issues. So today we have come up with a very interesting topic and we call it, do we need menstrual leave policy in India? I'm pretty sure all of us would have heard about what menstrual leave policy is, why have nations implementing menstrual leave policies and such for their female employees, looking forward for their menstrual as well as their reproductive health, especially concerned for women who've been going through unskilled labor, requiring a lot of physical effort and jobs that are associated with a lot of physical effort, especially during the period of menstruation on a monthly basis. So let's discuss about the historical overview, what all attempts have been made in India for the implementation of menstrual leave policy and many other interesting aspects as well. So before we begin, let's just say, what is menstruation? What do we understand about menstruation? In plain words, in layman's language, let's call it a simple biological process. An inevitable, simple biological process. Sorry, not so simple, but complex. Because for certain women, menstruation comes in a symptomatic form, while others, it is either asymptomatic or very much with lesser symptoms as such. The major symptoms that are associated with menstruation include both physical and mental differences that have been prevalent. In the physical aspect, this include dysmenorrhea, nausea, heavy bleeding, cramps, fatigue attached to them. Then premenstrual symptoms are existent, hormonal imbalances are present in a lot of people. Then mood swings, like we all are pretty aware about, and all these things are attached to menstruation of women on a monthly basis. So to discuss historically about menstrual leave policy as such, it would date back to 1920s. It would date back to Bolshevik Revolution in Russia, where sexual equality, the indifferences or the differences that have been prevalent between men and women when women were not allowed to vote, or a period where women were not allowed to vote, were not allowed to go for work, and they were like completely being tied up to their household chores and other aspects. There was a period in Russia where they as a part of the revolution, they wanted to ensure sexual equality in the country. As a part of the law, the female employees were called back or were being invited to work along with men, in par with men in these workplaces. So as a result of which, the revolution in Russia also initiated to make sure that the health, the hygiene, all other aspects related to women employees were well checked within their permits and were very much ensured back then in the revolution. So as a result of which, a lot of labor conditions were improved back then. And one such condition that they've come forth was the menstrual leave policy, which was a short period of leave that was initiated for women, for female employees at their workplaces back in Russia. Now, coming to the period that we are currently in now, one of the effective initiatives that have been taken from the United Nations include, or that of the United Nations Population Fund, that had come up with the United Nations Sexual and Reproductive Health Agency that had almost declared a day that was 28th of May of every year to be observed as Menstrual Hygiene Day. This is looking forward to ensure that the menstrual health, the hygiene that was associated with the menstruation of the women were ensured without any compromise. So if you take menstrual health into consideration, it definitely becomes or constitutes a major human rights of women. When menstrual hygiene is concerned, that includes right to human dignity, education, health, work, health and women, above all right to life. So when we consider menstrual leave policy, it is not a very simple or silly policy consideration that has been brought forth by people on a very long time. But it is something that has a very huge ambit in the existent health and welfare system of women in our country. So like I said just before, for different people, for different women, menstruation comes or creates different symptoms. Like I said, there are like severe symptoms for several women and feeble symptoms for others. While the most common symptoms include cramping, back pain, bloating, fatigue, and statistically this affects almost 14 to 25% of women, and this is inclusive of other symptoms like endometriosis, dysmenorrheal fibroids and polycystic ovarian syndrome, premenstrual dysphonic disorder, and several other implications are also a part of menstruation for a lot of women. Now, I'm pretty much interested to talk about numerous nations that have been following menstrual leave policy or that have been predominantly inserted menstrual leave policy in their respective labor codes. Japan, Indonesia, Taiwan, South Korea, Vietnam, and a few other notable Chinese forces, and even Zambia has included menstrual leave policy in their work, in their labor code. So these countries have included this into their respective labor codes of both public as well as private sectors. The intent behind this is to improve the situation through which female employees have been working on a very long period of time. And this definitely has a commendable cue for countries like, I mean, they very preferably act as a cue for countries like India and other Asian giants to deliberate and think about the need to have menstrual leave policy for women in our country. Moreover, the historical aspect of our country have a few nuances to be mentioned on why do we need menstrual policy in India. And one such example I'm being reminded of is what had happened back then in Australia, where Australian Manufacturing Workers Union, AMWU, movement had been led back in the past with female workers in Toyota, or their branches of Toyota in Australia, which was almost like they demanded for 12 days leave per year for the female employees, which was one among the 600 improvements that they had sought for the development of the working atmosphere of female employees back in Toyota showrooms in Australia. And obviously menstrual leave policy stayed to be an obvious demand of demand for the betterment of the health of the female employees in the country. The movement in Australia back then received a lot of international attention, and that would have been part of major deliberations in different countries that looked forward to create menstrual leave policy for women. Now, when it comes to Japan, Asian countries like that of Japan, under Article 68 of Labour Standards Law of that country, and even Indonesia, under Labour Act No. 13, 2003, and South Korea under Article 71 of Labour Standards Law. When it comes to Taiwan under the Act of Gender Equality in the Employment, all these are a few of the legislations that they've incorporated for the purpose of menstrual leave policy provision for their female employees in India, sorry, for those countries. In Europe, on the argument that the policy might project women as ill in possibilities of perpetuating sexism, the policy was not enacted in Europe irrespective of a proposal that was made. However, why did I mention Zambia in a very particular aspect is that Zambia, that is in Africa, has made a personal contribution towards the need of this legislation in 2015 that had raised debates across the country. Considering the women population that have been working, that has been working in Zambia, this seems to be an extensively progressive and daring move from the government of Zambia. In a nation where the entire aspect, the entire biological process of menstruation being considered to be a taboo or a stigmatized aspect there, they still came up with this policy in the nation, drawing a lot of attention towards it. And they referred this or this grueling menstrual pain of women or female employees could be met with. The policy was named as the Mother's Day. Leave provision, which is nomenclature, suggests irrespective of being a mother or not. Mother's Day was the name of the leave that the women, the female employees could avail during the days of their periods in Zambia. Now, menstrual leave policy has been a topic of legislative debate in India for a very long period of time. But I'm pretty much concerned that I must include the historical step that was taken by the state of Kerala back then in 1912. This was undertaken by a headmaster of a school, and this this step that was taken by the headmaster of this state school in Kerala, in the place called Thiruponithara, was with the intention to curtail the problem of absenteeism of female students of the school who could not write exams, who were absent for the exams because of their menstrual periods and their problems attached to it. And the school took an initiative of providing menstrual leave for their female children, for their female students, in order to prevent or in order to eradicate the problem of absenteeism in the school. Moreover, there were other proposals attempted by parliamentarians in different state governments as well. One such is that of Arunachal Pradesh, where Ninong Ering, who brought in menstruation benefit bill of 2017 as a private member's bill in the parliament. And this had a proposal which would take almost 12 days of leave per month for both public and private sectors, according to the bill. And the bill focused on the requirement of reproductive health and menstrual health of female employees, and it was to be pursued by the Ministry of Women and Child Development. Another noteworthy attempt to be noted from again the state of Kerala was by Dr. Shashi Tharoor, who had come up with a women's sexual, reproductive and menstrual rights bill which had particularly discussed about sexual and menstrual reproductive health of women, which also had a very specific mention about the requirement for menstrual leave policy, apart from which distribution of free sanitary napkins for women and several other amenities for female employees of the country. Further, there was another demand for the menstrual leave policy from Kerala. Further, again, was echoed in the state of Kerala by Mr. K.S. Shabarinathan, who was a legislative assembly member back then, to grant a period leave for every woman in almost every working sectors of economy. This is almost proceeded by the state of Kerala, but the progress still remains frozen even now. In the absence of any central government policy that we should definitely state and note what Bihar has been following ever since 1992, where its employees receive 2 days of leave every month with regard to their menstruation. This was identified to be a very revolutionary step, and this was undertaken post a number of demands and a 32-day long strike undertaken by female employees, where they demanded for a menstrual leave for at least 2 days per month consecutively, and this ended up being a very progressive voice from the state of Bihar. The current notion both private work environment offers to employees, also inspired from the menstrual leave policies introduced by business entities like Nike by addition of the policy into its code of conduct 2007, was one such step taken by organizations like that of Nike. And recently in the year 2017, a very popular news channel come newspaper agency Matrubhumi in 2017 had introduced menstrual leave policy for their female employees by the media group Matrubhumi in 2017, and two Mumbai based startup companies, Culture Machine, which was a digital startup, and even Gozoop, a digital marketing organization, and even Zomato, to be very noted, the online platform for food delivery, which resulted in nationwide debates and other applauses for their measures by taking menstrual leave policy for their female employees. These organizations have set up a very huge example for every single private and public entities in our country to come forward with short-term menstrual leave policies for women on a monthly basis. And now the major concepts that literally object the entire concept of menstrual policy are a few that I'll try to address on question of relevance of the policy and why the objections will not stand a chance against these same. One question of relevance of the policy is answered by the numerous menstrual symptoms and premenstrual symptoms women undergo on a different basis. It changes or it is different from one person to another, for which the example of a person who is not symptomatic during their periods cannot be considered or cannot be compared with another woman. And the question of feasibility and technical plausibility of a policy like for menstrual leave could be easily addressed with a comparative analysis that can be undertaken with the help of different countries that have made this policy a reality, irrespective of the economic background, irrespective of the social and cultural stigmas and taboos attached to menstruation. When it comes to question of law, inclusive of discrimination implying sexism, and that's the constitutionality of having this policy being addressed on, we could refer to the existence of parental leave policies that nations are coming with, maternity leave policies that are already prevalent in nations like India. Why are we avoiding a situation like menstrual leave, which only demands for an optional and a very short period of menstrual leave for women on a yearly or on a monthly basis at their respective workplaces? So it does not constitute discrimination, rather it constitutes equity for every single female employees who suffer during the days of their periods. Moreover, the policy is not meant to project menstruation as a weakness or as a lack of quality employment as such, but it is an inevitable biological process that women undergo, and for certain and for a few of them it definitely requires the support with the help of the leave policy that they could avail to ensure their hygiene, their health, especially for those women who undertake unskilled labor, which requires a lot of physical effort from their end. That is only because a few are asymptomatic towards the menstruation. It cannot be considered as a common case or general case, for example, in any manner. And if any problems of misusing the leave as such could be brought into picture, A very definite amount of leaves can be provided according to the labor policy of the respective institution, and this could be made use of with the medical reasoning of women, which could be provided as an optional case for the female employees as such. Therefore, menstrual leave policy, if introduced in India, will be a very remarkable, a progressive step towards, which is very much adaptive and tolerant towards the menstrual health and hygiene of women or the female employees in our country. With which I would like to conclude, and I would definitely like to know about your opinions on, do we need menstrual leave policy in India? I was satisfied with the, beginning of the objections that are existent against menstrual leave policy in India. What are the technical impossibilities that are attached to menstrual leave policy in India? So just answer these questions in the comment box, and you can share it with your friends if you feel that this has to be heard by them. And yes, stay tuned to Argumenta Podcast. We are available in Spotify, Anchor, iTunes, YouTube, Instagram, and every single platforms you are aware about. So once again, stay tuned for more amazing contents.